Hare Krishna. So today we continue our discussion on the pastime of Vritrasura and his transformation from demoniac to extraordinarily devoted. Yesterday I talked about, in the first part of this session, how within our consciousness there are conscious, subconscious and unconscious levels of levels or layers of experience and impressions that we have. Conscious is what we are aware of. It's like what is on the computer screen or what is where our flashlight in the room is focused. The subconscious is what is the data in the computer but which is not yet opened. So it's like the various things in the room on which the flashlight is not there. And the unconscious is like the hidden files in the computer, like the data under, like the things under a trap door in a house. So our actions normally are shaped by the conscious and the subconscious. The unconscious also shapes, but it's at a very, very subtle level, which is often not visible. And in this life, when we act in particular ways, it could be our mentality could be shaped by the birth, by the samskaras from the previous life, by the kind of parents from whom we are born, and also from the kind of upbringing that we get. And then beyond these three factors which shape our upbringing, there are also three other factors. There is, as we grow up, the kind of association we have that also shapes our behavior. Then there is also the kind of, apart from all these, we have our free will, and how we use our free will also determines the nature of our actions. And beyond them, ultimately is Krishna's grace. So Krishna's mercy can manifest and change things in a dramatic way. So these various factors, the factors from the previous life, the Purva Samskara, the factors from this life, that is the Janma and the lineage and the upbringing, along with the association, they all push our free will in particular ways. They push, but they don't force. And we always have the capacity to counter push, so that our free will can actually be used to resist some of those influences. Now, sometimes all these three, four influences can act in one way. Say if somebody was an alcoholic in the previous life, now they are born in an alcoholic family, and they grow up seeing their parents drink alcohol, and then even when they grow up, the locality in which they live, everybody is drinking alcohol. So then previous and this life's factors all combine together to push them in a particular direction, that is to drink alcohol. So when Krishna's mercy comes into the picture, Krishna's mercy can act in two ways. One is that by his mercy, our free will gets more power to push back. When we are pushed in a particular direction to resist or to push back, our free will's power increases. So if a boulder has to be pushed uphill, then if the boulder is very big, then it will push us down. It will roll over us. But if we become stronger, then our capacity to push it increases. And so conversely, if the boulder keeps becoming bigger and bigger, if say it is a mud boulder or a snow boulder, a snowball, and as it's accumulating more and more mud or snow and growing bigger, then also pushing it will be difficult. But if it becomes smaller, then pushing it will become easier. So Krishna's mercy can either increase our capacity to push by making us stronger. Krishna's mercy can also come by decreasing the size of the boulder. The boulder here I am using to refer to all the factors from the previous life, from the previous life as well as this life till now. Now here we are using one boulder which is pushing us down, and we are pushing it up. But there may not be one boulder like that. The boulder example is simply for simple understanding. Yesterday I gave the example also of an ocean in which there may be different currents and different layers. So we see that the previous life and this life. The previous life, not the previous life's whole life for Vritrasura, but the previous life's curse and this life's birth and this life's upbringing, even this life's association, all of them were pushing Vritrasura to act in demoniac ways. And when he sees Indra discouraged, he actually is still very angry. And he first speaks according to his demonic nature. And he says, "Oh Indra, you wretched person, you are actually a killer of your own brother, you are a killer of your guru, and you are a killer of, you are killer of my brother, you are killer of a brahmana, and you are killer of my guru, of your guru." Because he had killed Vishwarupa. He said, "Therefore, I will punish you and I will kill you." So, he says over here, this is text 15, 6, 11, 15. Yo no agrajasyatma vido dvijater guror papasya cha dikshitasya vishrabhyakhadgena shiramsya avrishyachat pashoriva karuna swarga kamaha. So, you killed him like an animal. Slaughterer might just slaughter an animal ruthlessly without caring for the animal at all. So, pashoriva karuna, heartlessly, without a karuna, you killed him. For what? Swarga kamaha. So, then he says, "Therefore, I will kill you today and I will attain peace for having, for your having killed my brother, I will take revenge for that." And then he goes on and says that I will do a yagya to Bhairav with your head and the heads of all the gods who have the audacity to fight by you, by your side, instead of fleeing away in fear. We see in the Vedic context, even the demons are not totally godless. Even the demons understand that they have to worship some higher beings by which they get some power. So, they just don't believe in Vishnu as a supreme being. And that's why we have Ravana worshipping Shiva, Hiranyakashipu worshipping Brahma. And here he is saying that I will perform a yagya to Bhairava. Now, this was the plan even of Jarasandha as well as of Bana, of Bhaumasura, Arkasura. So there's Banasura, there many of the Asuras in Krishna Lila also have this plan that they will perform some yagya. So here, although he's performing yagya, that yagya to a devata is not done out of piety. It is done simply, it is actually, there is some level of piety in it, but it is done simply to increase one's power by using the demigods as almost like a mechanical tool for gaining that power. Earlier I mentioned how yagya can be like a weapons, is not a weapon manufacturing unit but a warrior manufacturing unit. So similarly, he wanted to perform yagya to increase his prowess. But as he is speaking like this, now Vritrasura also has mystic powers. And he knows that Indra has got a particular astra, a vajra, not his own ordinary, his own vajra, which is his Indra is famed for his thunderbolt, which is itself very powerful. But Indra has got something more. Indra has got a vajra made from the body of Dadichi. And that has been given to him as per the plan of Vishnu. And he knows that he is going to die at the hands of, due to that vajra. So after he's exhorting him, after he's castigating him, saying him that you are a killer and therefore you deserve to be killed and you will be killed. He speaks in, he says that I'll perform a yagya to Bhairava, he doesn't even say that I will use your head. I will use the head of the devatas who stand by you and I will perform a yagya to Bhairava with their heads. And he says, your body, I will kill it, I will destroy it, and I will throw it to the vultures. You are so sinful that your body doesn't even, your head doesn't even deserve to be offered to Bhairav, because you are the killer of a Brahmana. So here he is impassioned with anger. Now, but suddenly he says that his mood changes. This is text 18. And then from text 18 onwards, his mood changes. So he says, text 18, Atho hare me kulishe navira harta pramathyaiva shiro yadiha tatrandrano bhutabalim vidhaya manasvinam padaraja praparce. Normally, when a warrior is fighting, warriors know at the back of their minds that they can die at any moment. In today's world, you may say a bullet may come and may knock them down or kill them, or in the past an arrow or some other missile may knock them down. But generally, when the warriors are fighting, they actually speak to praise their own strength and to minimize their opponent's strength. And in this way, in war, a major factor is intimidation. War is not just a physical confrontation, it is also a mental confrontation. The person who is mentally stronger, their spirit will stay stronger, and that person will be able to fight longer as and when it's necessary. So generally, warriors do not show any weakness, especially when they are confronting the other person. They express full confidence that I am going to send you to the abode of death. So till this point, till text 17, Vritrasura is speaking like a typical demon. And then suddenly in text 18, here is mood changes. Atho hare me kulishe navira. If however, hare. So hare refers to King Indra. Kulishe navira. That if like, there is a Trishula, so Kulishena refers to here the thunderbolt. If you thunderfold, O hero, Veera, if you kill me, Harta Pramathyaiva Shiro Yadhiha, if you cut off my head and destroy my army, Tatrandrano Bhutabalim Vidhaya, then I will Bhutabalim Vidhaya. I will offer my body as a sacrifice for the benefit of all living beings. Bhuta Bali means sacrifice. So I'll offer it as a sacrifice, and then Manasvinam Padaraja Prapatsye. And in this way, I will attain the dust of the Manasvis, the dust of the lotus feet of the Manasvis, Padarajam. So Manasvi here refers to great sages like Narad Muni. Now, he doesn't mention the word Narad Muni explicitly, but it's understood from his previous life, because Narad Muni and Parvat Muni were the two sages who instructed him. So he's thinking, I will attain the dust of their lotus feet. I will attain their association. Now this is a sudden change. Indra himself is startled by this. What is going on over here? And then now he says, not only does he say that he entertained the possibility of his death, but then he goes ahead and he starts encouraging Indra, exhorting Indra. Suresha kasman nahino shivajram purasthite vairini mayamogham ma samshaistha nagadeva vajraha syanishvala krupanarthe vayachna. So he says, ma samshaistha shishtha, don't have doubt that nagadeva vajraha, that just as your gada was foiled, that this vajra will also be foiled. Syanishvala krupanarthe vayachna. Don't think it will be like if somebody goes and asks money from a miser. Then all that one will get from a miser is misery, not money. The miser will reject, will scorn, will deride, And such a appeal, the archana is itself useless. But that is not the case. That is not only the case with you, O Prince, this is amogha, this is infallible. The weapon, the vajra which you have got is infallible. Suresha kasman hinoshi vajram. Therefore, O Suresha, O King of the Gods, Suraisha, why are you hesitating? Why are you not throwing your vajra? Do not think that it will not work. This is extraordinary. Normally, a warrior would tell the opposite warrior that your weapons are not going to work. He is assuring him here instead that your weapon will surely work. It is infallible. Why would anyone give the opponent the faith that their weapon will work? Generally, when wars take place, there is something called deterrence. Deterrence means that if you do this, then I will do this to you. And because of that fear, the other person will not do that. If you see in the last 30-40 years, we have not had major wars, although there are major conflict zones. Say India-Pakistan had wars until 1960s, in 1970, but by the 1990s, both India and Pakistan have developed nuclear weapons. And nuclear weapons act as a deterrent. Even there have not been any major conflicts between, say, USSR and USA after the Cold Wars, because nuclear weapons act as a deterrent. Now, I'm not supporting nuclear weapons in any way. All that I'm saying is that deterrence is a important factor. Deterrence comes by awareness of the opponent's fearful power to retaliate. So, based on that, an opponent may torment a little bit. There might be some below the surface invisible or low visibility conflicts might go on, but a full scale war won't break out. Similarly here, normally in order to deter the opponent from fighting wholeheartedly, one speaks about the power of one's own weapons and one minimizes the power of the other's weapons. But here he is exhorting, he is encouraging his opponent and is assuring him that your weapon will surely have power. Now, how does he say this? Why is it going to work? Nanvai shivajrastava shakra tejasa harer dadhiche stapasa chatejitaha tenaiva shatrum jahi vishnu yantrito yato harir vijaya shri gunas tataha. So, this vajra is not driven by your power like the gada was. So, he is telling him that if it's your power fighting against my power, I will be victorious. But it's not your power fighting against my power. It is Vishnu's power. Harer dadhiches tapasat tejitaha. That Hare, it is by Lord Hari's arrangement. On top of it, there is dadhichi's power with it. So, tenaiva shatrum jahi Vishnu yantrito. So, therefore, he uses the word twice. Here the word Harer refers to Hari, Lord Hari. And Vishnu yantrito, this is arranged by Vishnu. Yato Harir Vijaya Shri Rigunastataha. And again, he uses the word Hari, third line also. Vijaya Shri. Wherever there is Hari, there will be Vijaya over there. So here we see the manifestation of his Krishna consciousness. Initially, he is looking at the confrontation in horizontal terms. Horizontal terms means that he is looking at this person is supposed to be a god, but he has acted in such an ungodly, brutal, vicious way. And there is a natural enmity between the gods and demons. That is at the material level, it is there. And on top of that, he has acted in a demoniac way. He has killed my brother. It's interesting that Vritrasura feels this filial fraternal brotherly affection, although he has never seen Vishwarupa. Vishwarupa died before he was born, but he understands that I have emerged from the same father, Tvashta. So he still feels that anger towards him. That is the nature of, we could say, family affection. That even the relatives whom we have not seen, even relatives we have passed away before we have taken birth, sometimes our life may be devoted to taking revenge on their behalf. That's how vendetta wars go on, generation after generation after generation. Your grandfather did this to my grandfather, therefore I will do this to you. Your grandfather did this to me, and then my uncle did this to you, but then your father did this to me, and now I'll go on. This will go on. So although he has not even seen Vishwarupa, still he is desiring to kill the killer of Vishwarupa. So this is at a horizontal level of consciousness, you versus me. But then his consciousness shifts. He doesn't say you versus me, he says beyond you to Krishna. And this is a consistent theme of the Srimad Bhagavatam, which we could succinctly put as, focus not on the wrongdoer, focus on the ultimate doer. Focus not on the wrongdoer, focus on the ultimate doer. Parikshit Maharaj does not focus on Sringi, who has cursed him to die. In fact, after the first canto, there is practically no reference to Sringi at all. Parikshit Maharaj is now feeling no resentment. Why did this boy curse me for just a small thing? But he just focuses on the ultimate doer. That is, Krishna has some plan, and let me just serve him and surrender to his plan. So this, looking at Krishna, this is, we could say, vertical vision. So the horizontal and the vertical, we are normally aware of both things. And there are situations where we serve someone and we serve Krishna through that person also. So we have family members, we take care of the family, take care of them. And they also become spiritually inclined, they also start practicing bhakti. Then our horizontal and vertical relationship both work together. Both work in parallel, but sometimes they may not work in parallel, sometimes they may work in opposition. When this happens, one has to be extremely cautious not to give up the horizontal whimsically for the vertical. But here he is not giving up, he is going to lose. So when he is about to lose the horizontal, he does not keep trying to hold on to it. Just as Parikshit Maharaj also did not hold on, he just lets go. So what happens? How does this transformation take place? The Bhagavatam does not explicitly indicate any change in terms of the narrative flow. It is within the conversation of Vritrasura that two, three verses he is speaking as a demon out to kill the natural antagonists of the demon, the Devata. But the next moment, he is actually speaking as a devotee. And we will see in subsequent verses, like when I said, don't focus on the wrongdoer, focus on the ultimate doer. We will see Vritrasura's focus shifting. 21st verse, he says that, he is still speaking to Indra, but then from the 22nd verse till the 27th verse where the chapter ends, he, although he is in the battlefield, although he is facing his opponent, he stops speaking to his opponent. He starts speaking to Vishnu. So first there is a conversation, then there is a reflection. Reflection means he stops really speaking to himself, he stops speaking to Indra. Although he's speaking aloud, he's almost like speaking to himself while incidentally addressing Indra. And then he starts addressing the Supreme directly. So text 22 describes his more introspective mood now. Pumsam kilaikanta dhiyam swakanam Ya sampado divi bhuma urasayam naratiya dvesha udvega adhir madah kalir vyasanam samprayasaha. So he says, pumsam kilaikant dhyam swakanam. So those people who are ekant dhya, who are wholeheartedly devoted to Lord Vishnu, Swakanam, they are Vishnu's own people. They are recognized by him. These are my people. These are my devotees. And he asks, Sampado Divi Bhuva Urasayam. He doesn't give them the property which might be available in this world, on the earth, in the heavens, or in the lower planets, Rasayam. Because such things only bring anxiety. Narati Yadvesha Udvega Adhir. It brings envy, it brings anxiety, it brings intoxication, it brings conflict. Madhik, madah, kalir, vyasanam, samprayasah. All these come up because of it. Doesn't give that. Then what does he do? Then amazing verse is here. This is very similar to Kunti Maharani's verse where let the calamities come. He doesn't pray that let the calamities come, but he describes how the calamity is also a mercy. Traivargikaya svigha tamasmat. Patir vidhatte purushasya shakra tato anumeyo bhagavat prasado yo durlabho kinchana gocharo anyai. So he says, traivargikayas, traivarga, trivarga. We know there is apavarga. Apavarga means the liberation, going beyond the categories of material pleasures. But before apavarga, there is traivarga. Traivarga is dharma, artha and kama. So, traivargikayas vighatamasmat. So, normally people worship God, their idea of success is dharma, artha, kama. But here he says, this aspiration vighatamasmat. The Lord destroys this. And pattir vidhatte purushasya shakra. Oh, shakra, just consider, this is what the Lord does to our devotees. Such is our Lord, Patir Vidhatti. So, Asmat means our. The our Lord is such that he never give this, he actually destroys the plan of his devotees to get this. He disrupts it, Vighatam, he ruins it. And Tato Anumeyo Bhagavat Prasado. So, when this is disrupted for someone, then I understand that this is Bhagavat Prasada. This is actually the mercy of the Lord. But most people think, what kind of mercy is this? This is not mercy, this is cruelty, this is catastrophe. And then he says, oh Indra, don't worry, you are not going to get this kind of mercy. Yo durlabho akinchana gocharonyai. This is a very rare kind of mercy which is given to akinchana gochara, those who are unalloyed devotees, those who are having no desire except the desire for Krishna. There is the famous verse which Krishna also speaks to Yudhishthira and which Prabhupada felt was happening to him in his life. Yasyaha manugrahanami harishyetad dhanam shani tato adhanam tajatyasya svajanam dukkha dukkhita. That one loses everything and everyone, one loses wealth and one loses people in one's life, and then such a person has no one except Vishnu to take shelter of. So, here Vritrasura is recognizing that he is going to get a special mercy of the Lord. That mercy which is not ordinarily available to anyone. And then from here onwards, from the 24th verse, there are very celebrated prayers of Vritrasura, where he desires to offer his whole being to the Supreme Lord. Aham hare tava padaika mula dasanu daso bhavitasmi bhuya. Manasmareta supate gunamste grunitva karma karotikaya. He says, my life, air, my breath, my words, my body, my everything, O Lord, I want to offer to you in a mood of service. So here we can clearly see that his vision has now shifted. It's not even reflection that is a glory that is incidentally being addressed to Indra. It is now direct appeal to the Lord. So by this time, Vritrasura has gone completely into Krishna consciousness. He is practically not aware of the presence of Indra is not even aware of being on a battlefield. He's absorbed in the Supreme Lord. So this transition from Chaitanya external consciousness to semi-external, semi-internal consciousness to, you could say, internal consciousness. Internal doesn't necessarily mean that he is thinking inwards, he's actually looking upwards over there. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was described in three kinds of consciousness at different times like this. Sometimes he will be vaguely aware of externals, sometimes he will be fully aware of externals, sometimes he would be utterly unaware of externals. So Vritrasura is transitioning from external consciousness towards internal consciousness, or from, we could say, horizontal awareness to vertical awareness, from awareness of the wrongdoer to awareness of the ultimate doer. For all of us, this is very instructive. And I'll talk about that as a conclusion, but before that, one point. Now, how does this transition happen for Vritrasura? As I said, the Bhagavatam itself does not, it only describes the transition. It does not describe the causes or the mechanisms of the transition. So, in the case of Bali Maharaj also, he is initially acting like a charitable person, acting at the level of Punya, giving charity at all costs. But then suddenly, we see in his talks, he changes to the level of Bhakti, where he wants to offer everything to Lord Vishnu. So, this transition actually happens by the mercy of the Lord. The circumstance, some circumstance can act as a trigger. If normally we are caught by the hope of material pleasure or the fear of material trouble, and these two are the primary factors that keep us moving in material consciousness. Material pleasure doesn't necessarily have to mean sensual pleasure. It can be pleasure of the ego. It can be various kinds of pleasure. So it is that pleasure that keeps driving us on. I will get this. I'll get this. I'll get this. I'll get this. Or it may be the fear of material trouble, that, oh, this will go wrong. This will go wrong. This will go wrong. But there are times which come in our life when the fear of material trouble becomes so overwhelming, or rather the material trouble becomes so overwhelming, that one realizes that there is just no security at the material level. Normally, when we feel that there is something in our control, we keep trying to do something or the other. But sometimes we face a situation where we realize that there's just nothing in my control, nothing that I can do. So when the material adversity becomes overwhelming, or when a very big crisis presents itself in front of us, at that time, that becomes an impetus, like a trigger for us to stop looking at ourselves and our endeavors, our capacity to endeavor also, and to look upwards toward the Supreme. Or sometimes we may get the material pleasure that we have dreamt of, and after getting that pleasure, we realize, hey, this is nothing, this is an anticlimax. What is the point of seeking this? What is the point of getting this? It's of no use. And that realization may also prompt us to change our ourselves, to change our consciousness, to change our way of thinking and look upwards. So for Vritrasura, the sight of Indra's Vajra, which is not Indra's Vajra actually, it is the Vajra given to Indra, that reminds him of Vishnu. And as soon as he is reminded of Vishnu, from that sight of the gift of Vishnu, reminds him of his previous life which was devoted to Vishnu. And that devotion, it's triggered, it is awakened. And once it is triggered, then it takes over. For the samskara, the bhakti practice that we have done, that lies in the remote background of our consciousness. Just like sometimes, if we have some container of water, a tank of water, or a small pond of water, then suddenly we might see some bubbles coming up over there. And those bubbles come from maybe some fermentation or some action that is happening at the bottom of the well or lower layers of the lake. From there it comes up. So similarly here, in this case, from the some trigger from above causes the impressions from the unconscious to suddenly surface, and they surface from the unconscious to the conscious level, and then that is where his consciousness becomes fully absorbed. So from external to reflective consciousness to internal consciousness, that journey happens because what is there in the unconscious, it comes to the subconscious, and then it comes to his full conscious awareness, and just starts surfacing up. So actually it is in this sense that neha bhikramanashosti pratyavayo na vidyate, that whatever bhakti we have performed, that is never lost forever. It may be covered because by our this life's upbringing, by our this life's choices, certain impressions may be formed on our conscious level of reality. And those impressions may obstruct the growth of our devotion. Even the manifestation of our devotion may be obstructed. But when this is simply at the surface level, and when that surface level is disrupted by some devastating situation, then what is below starts manifesting. But that situation is not the cause of the manifestation of the devotion. Situation is simply the trigger. Sometimes you may hear some stories about, say, some devotees, they were some Prabhupada disciples or some other senior devotees, very serious in practicing bhakti, and then they get cancer. Then they leave the practice of bhakti, or they become lax in their practice, and then they get cancer. And when they get cancer, then they suddenly become serious. Some devotees, and they say that, you know, that maybe if I'm not serious about my bhakti, maybe if I get cancer, then I will also become serious. Now, cancer is not the producer of devotion. It is the mercy of the Lord which causes us some samskara from the past which we have done, that to manifest, inspire us to transform. And that's what is the cause of devotion. Otherwise, there are millions of people who get terminal cancer and other such terminal diseases. They don't become devotees. They don't become devotees at that time. So, for a devotee, the mercy of the Lord is such that the devotee is able to break free from resentment, from revengefulness, and focus on the divine. And thus, Vritrasura becomes transformed because he completely focuses on the divine. And eventually, when Indra, exhorted by Vritra, cuts off his head, actually the cutting off his head is this external event. Even before that, Vritrasura has become absorbed in Vishnu, and Vishnu Chakratakur explains that Vritrasura is, because of his internal absorption, Vishnu already has attained Vishnu, and Indra is devoured by Vritrasura through his open huge mouth, and Indra from inside Vritrasura's body works, because he is protected by the Vajra, he doesn't die. He works from inside the body to, is protected by his kavach actually, by the armor. He works from inside the body to cut off Vritrasura's belly and come out. And that's when to the world it appears as he's been victorious, as if. But even before that, Vritrasura has been victorious, because Vritrasura by his absorption in Vishnu has already attained Vishnu. So for all of us, when we are practicing bhakti, when certain people do something wrong to us, we have a choice of being either resentful or revengeful. No, why did this person do like this to me? How dare they do like this? And if they do like that, I will show them what I can do. Or we can see their action as an impetus for focus, shifting the focus from the wrongdoer to the ultimate doer. Now that doesn't mean we completely neglect the wrongdoer. We may have to respond appropriately, which means sometimes we may have to take the disciplinary action also, like the Pandavas did against the Kauravas. But the Pandavas were not obsessed with taking revenge against the Kauravas. Otherwise, if that had been the case, they would not have proposed the Shantidut proposal peace message. But they proposed that because they were focused on the ultimate doers. When they fought the war also, they fought it not so much to take revenge as to serve Krishna and assist him in his purpose of establishing dharma. During the day-to-day practice of our sadhana bhakti, as we strive to become conscious of the ultimate doer more and more, through our japa, through our shravan, through our puja, by this, as we strive to become conscious of the ultimate doer more and more, then even in the routine course of our life, we won't be obsessed with the immediate doer, the wrongdoer, but our consciousness will shift to the ultimate doer, and then we will respond in a mood of service to the ultimate doer. In the mood of service to the ultimate doer, sometimes you may just tolerate and forgive the wrongdoer. Sometimes you may decide to take some actions against the wrongdoer also. But our consciousness won't be consumed with the wrongdoer. Our consciousness will be elevated to the ultimate doer, and we will act in the mood of service to that ultimate doer. And thus, we will grow spiritually through even the negativities, distresses, injustices that we may face at the hands of others. So Vritrasura attains the supreme victory, whereas Indra gets only a transitional victory. Transitional victory is he wins the battle, but Vritrasura wins the war against illusion. Sometimes when we have an argument with someone, at that time our love for Krishna should raise us above the need to win every argument. Sometimes the ego feels the need. I have to prove that I am right and you are wrong. But if we are devoted to Krishna, if we have security in our relationship with Krishna, if we are confident that what I was doing was well-intentioned, it was rightly done. But if somebody has some issues with that, if we feel inspired that way at that time, then we may decide this is not a battle I want to fight. So we may say that there's a question of right and wrong. Yes, but ultimately we have to see that there's right and wrong at the horizontal level, there's right and wrong at the vertical level. That at the horizontal level, Indra was wrong to have killed Vishwarup like that. But Indra, Vritrasura did not focus on that. He focused on what was right at the spiritual level, and that was, he chose that course of action which will enable him to rise towards Vishnu. So we needn't be driven by the need to prove the other person wrong and prove ourselves right. We can be driven by the need to move towards Krishna. And sometimes for moving towards Krishna, sometimes for serving Krishna, we may try to argue and prove that we are right and the others are wrong. But that need not be the driving need for us. We can focus not on who is right in the horizontal argument, but we can focus on what is right in the vertical progression. So sometimes we may willingly accept defeat in an argument, but by that we may attain victory in the ultimate purpose of life. And this dynamic of defeat at the horizontal level and victory at the vertical level is what the Bhagavatam demonstrates repeatedly and especially dramatically through this pastime of Vritrasura. I'll summarize. I spoke today about the dramatic transformation of Vritrasura, how it happens. So I quoted some passages from the Vritrasura pastime wherein initially he's acting like a typical demon, determined to avenge the death of his brother at the hands of Indra, and determined to perform a yajna to increase the power of the demons, in his own power, a yajna to Bhairava. But as he is doing this, suddenly at one particular moment his consciousness changes. He moves from addressing Indra to telling him that I'll kill you, to addressing Indra that you can kill me, have confidence. Normally warfare is not just a physical warfare, there's also mental warfare. So normally Kshatriyas intimidate their opponents by expressing confidence in their own prowess and by deriding the power of the opponents. So by this there is a deterrent element by which the opponent may not become excessively aggressive. Like nuclear deterrence can prevent a full-scale war from happening. And then talked about how Vritrasura's mood changes. Then from encouraging Indra, he starts just reflecting internally about the glories of the Lord and the Lord's inconceivable form. Traivargikayas vighatamasmat. Patir vidate purushasya chakra. That Lord destroys the aspirations for dharma artha kama, which is what Indra is aiming for, Indra is dreaming about. But he says such is a mercy that is not given to everybody. Though durlabho akinchina gocharai is given to those who are purely devoted. And he reveals himself to be purely devoted by shifting his consciousness entirely towards the Lord. So I talked about Krishna's mercy. It can come in two broad forms. If the boulder is pushing us down and we are trying to push it up, the boulder can become weakened. The boulder refers to our samskaras from the previous life, our genealogy in this life, our upbringing in this life. And Krishna can also increase our strength to push it up. That means our free will, which can counter push all these influences. Now, sometimes these influences which are forcing us, some of them may be spiritually positive, some of them is spiritually negative. So for Vritrasura, most of them were spiritually negative. That's why he's acting demoniac. But there was the spiritually positive influence from his previous life's devotion. And that manifested when there was, when there's the extremes at the material level. Normally, we work in material consciousness with the hope for pleasure or with the fear of trouble, to get the pleasure or to avoid the trouble. But sometimes the pleasure, we get it and we find it's pointless, and then we start looking for something higher. Or sometimes the trouble just goes on and seems irresolvable. And then we look for something upwards. What can I get? What can I do? So the situation, however, is not the cause of the devotion. The situation is simply the trigger. The mercy of the Lord, which activates some past samskara, bhakti samskara, that is the cause. Just like water suddenly ferments from the bottom of a pond upwards. And a devotee prays not so much for the calamity, the devotee may do that, the devotee actually prays for the mercy. And for us, when we are practicing bhakti, when we face external problems, especially problems in terms of somebody troubling us too much, then instead of staying in horizontal consciousness and becoming resentful or revengeful, try to focus on how best we can serve Krishna. Focus not on the wrongdoer, focus on the ultimate doer. The test of our devotion is that we are not driven by the ego's need to prove ourselves right in every argument. We are ready to just put some argument aside, even if we are right, if that is what is right for our spiritual growth. And Vritrasura, although defeated materially, defeated in the war, battle against Indra, emerges victoriously in the war against illusion. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Is there any one quick question?
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. Dandavat.
Prabhu, could you explain the horizontal and vertical positions that you have mentioned?
Okay. What are the horizontal and vertical that I mentioned? The relationships in this world and our relationships beyond this world. Say, for example, the way we interact with each other, one jiva interacting with another jiva is horizontal relationship. But the jiva interacting with Jagdish, with the Supreme Lord, that is the vertical relationship. So we are mostly caught in, you did like this to me, how, and therefore I will do this to you. But if we can shift our consciousness, okay, this person did like this to me, but what is Krishna trying to teach me through this? And how can I serve Krishna in this situation? Then we are focusing on the vertical. We're focusing on the mood of service to Krishna and striving to serve Krishna through that situation. Does that answer your question?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. Any other question? Yes, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yes.
Namaskar.
ma'am. Hello. Thank you so much, Prabhu. Prabhu, I want to know that Vritrasura is in the beginning is demonic. He was demon and then he got suddenly he got that he saw his emotional attitude. It means in the devotee's case, in certain time we may develop that kind of thing. Some devotees who have you were telling because he had some sukriti in the previous time and he suddenly started remembering Narada Muni and this Bhagavatam Muni. When it happens suddenly in some case, Prabhu.
So can for devotees also it happen that suddenly?
Yeah, they can manifest your emotional service till the time because my understanding he had some offenses he did because of that he had got that demon his body, but when his offenses nullify and then after that he got the remember his emotional past life before.
Yeah, that's true. So, is it for a devotee, for Uttarasur, was it because of his offense that he was covered over and then when that offense period expired, then that's how his devotion manifested? Yes, that's true. See, for everything that happens, there can be multiple levels of explanation. Say, if somebody gets malaria, we could say, that this person got malaria because the mosquito bit them and some microbes infected that person. But now in that same house, there might be so many people staying. Did the mosquito bite only this person? Now we may say that actually no, but you know everybody has different immunity levels. But sometimes two people, if you measure their immunity levels, they may be exactly similar also. But still one person gets malaria, the other doesn't get malaria. So it is that there is also some purva karma involved. And even when cure is happening, two people may take the same medicine, but they may not get cured in the same time. One person may get cured in 2-3 days, another may take 2-3 months to get cured also. If a particular kind may lead to another disease or it may lead to some complication. So we usually say that karma is the system of action and reaction, which is true. But it is not a simple system. It is not that action A will lead to reaction B. And action A can be combined with the reactions to past actions and then it can lead to reaction B. So it may be that this life's action and previous life's action may combine together to give a particular reaction. So, if an ordinary person say overeats sweets, they might just feel sleepy for some time. They might just gain a little weight. But for them, they might get a severe health attack by that. So, it's that their eating sweets is not the only factor which is causing the situation. It is the overall health of the health condition also. So, similarly, we can look at multiple layers of explanation for things. So, yes, it was definitely the offense which had covered him over, because of which he had to get a demonic body. But the point I was making here is that what brought about the transformation? Parvati did not say that for a particular duration this curse will remain and then the curse will go away. Like Nalakuvar and Manigriv, for them, Narada Muni specifically promised them that Lord Krishna will deliver you. Krishna will deliver you in a future life when you are living as trees. There also he did not say, but there we can see Krishna act in the Yamalajan trees, and that's how Nalakuvar and Manigriva delivered. But there is no such specific statement made with Parvati. So we can look at a circumstantial level, and circumstantial level actually we will not see any sudden change. But what we do see is that when he is in that final fight, his consciousness suddenly shifts from Indra to Vishnu. And we can trace this back to his previous life. So what offenses do is, offenses basically they block our access to our own devotion. It's like there's a poor person who has no money at all. As a wealthy person who has a lot of money, say in the treasury, but they have lost the key to the treasury. Or somebody has a credit card, but they have lost the code of the credit card. And they have the money, but they can't access it. So like that, what offenses do is that the word offense is related with the word fence. Basically, there is a fence of proper behavior. When we transgress and behave improperly, especially we behave maliciously trying to put down some person, then that is when we violate that fence, then what happens is the fence, which is initially a protector for us, like for Draupadi, for Sita, the Lakshman Rekha was the protector for her. But then when she came out, then Ravana abducted her and took her to Lanka, and Lanka became a fence for her. It was surrounded by the oceans and she just couldn't go anywhere. So initially the fence that protects our devotion, that protects us from sin, if we violate that through offense, then that offense changes the nature of the fence so that we become fenced out of our devotion. So we get trapped somewhere else in a particular consciousness, that our devotion, our own devotion is no longer accessible to us. But when that offense is, when the right time comes, then actually we become aware and then we move beyond the offense. We move beyond the result of the offense. So we were looking, now if we have committed some offenses also, we don't know about what we may have committed in the previous life. But we can look at the circumstantial situation and we can look at what Vritrasura did and we can try to do that. So we can try to raise our consciousness from the horizontal to the vertical. Does that answer your question?
Yes, Prabhu. For that, we need Krishna's mercy. Yes, I mean, he will create the situation that we can realize. Yes, Prabhu?
Yes, we need Krishna's mercy, but we also need to make our endeavor. Now, Vritrasura could have stayed consumed by Indra. So when something prodded him from within, you know, raise your consciousness towards Krishna, he did that. And that's how he was elevated.
Okay. Thank you. So I have one question regarding yesterday's class.
The last question. After this question, we'll stop then.
Yes.
Thank you.
Nobody has
seen
my last letter.
Yes, ma'am. Please go ahead.
Okay, Prabhu. So you are telling subconsciousness and consciousness and then unconsciousness in actually class. My question is regarding also you were telling the samskara. And then from samskara, especially I wanted to ask regarding fish. They brought some samskara from the previous, some kind of things in previous life, and they will learn from this life, impressions. I just want to know, especially in the kids growing Krishna consciousness, how we can be the better impression in Krishna consciousness. Because you were telling the main thing, they will only get some kind of karma to go further in Krishna consciousness. But how we can create that impression? That is only effect, yes? It's external, you are telling external activities, physical activities is depend on the what we teach, our parents teach, and then internal consciousness, they will get from their previous life, yes? You were telling?
No, internal consciousness is shaped by previous life as well as this life. It is not that one is a, I was saying that consciousness is shaped by both externals that we have as well as the internals. It is not just this or that, it is this and that. So as far as our children are concerned, how can we give them devotional impressions? Yes, there are various samskaras, but more important than the samskaras is the overall culture and conduct. If we ourselves are devoted to Krishna and our children see that we are affectionate towards them, and our devotion makes us better parents, makes us more loving, more kind, more understanding, more caring for them as parents, then they will remember that. Even if in the teenage the hormones start rising within them and they drag them in this other direction, they will come back in the right direction eventually by the impressions. Generally, one living being can influence another living being only in three broad ways. We could say enlightenment, encouragement, and engagement. Enlightenment means we can tell, give knowledge of this choice will lead to this consequence, this choice will lead to that consequence, that choice will lead to that consequence. That's enlightenment. Then there is engagement. Engagement means, okay, if this is the path you want to, this is the path that is good for you, how can you practically go along that path? Now, if you want the kids to practice bhakti, children to practice bhakti, now they cannot come and, they normally, when some of them may come and hear classes for adults, but they need some forum for themselves also. Something where maybe they can do drama, they can do some kirtan, they can hear classes for their level, they can get their level of association. It's some kind of facility for them to practice. So encourage, so then we need engagement, enlightenment, and encouragement. Everybody needs to be positively encouraged in the practice of bhakti. If our interaction with them is only do this, why are you not doing that, why are you not doing that, then that is quite discouraging. If they do even some small thing in bhakti and we encourage them for that, then that is how they will move forward. So if we are doing these three things, we are doing our part. Enlightenment, engagement, encouragement, if we are providing, then we are doing our part. And then each soul is a soul with free will, and sooner or later each soul will turn towards Krishna. So we can facilitate that from our side, but we don't have to become overly attached, and we don't have to become insecure. And if our children are not taking a bhakti, we shouldn't think of that as a personal failure, because then we may pressurize them too much to practice bhakti. And our own insecurity cannot be the basis for anyone else's spirituality. Our own insecurity means, oh, what will people think of me? What will the devotee community, others think of me if my child doesn't become a devotee? And that insecurity, if because of that we pressurize our children to become devotees, then they will catch it that we are not really concerned about them so much. We are concerned about our own reputation. So everybody goes through various stages in their spiritual life, and not everybody is ready to take up spiritual life immediately. Even when 5000 years ago the pious culture was there, even at that time most people would live pious lives. Even at that time devotees were rare. So now Kali Yuga is the age of adharma, it's not even the age of punya. So now we cannot expect to change what is the traditional order of things and expect that everybody whom we come in contact with through relationships or through associations will take up bhakti. So each soul is at their own level of spiritual evolution, and they will take up gradually. So we keep the door open for them, and they will walk through the door at the right time. If not immediately, if not consistently throughout their life, there might be some time they go off track, but soon they will come back, because the impressions will be there, and the impressions will draw them back to Krishna. Thank you very much. Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Gaur Bhaktavrinda ki jai. Nitai Gaur Premanande. Hari Hari Bol.